Hello guys, this is a video for a storm and how to render in a storm data in Blender. Now in Blender 3.1, we will have a lot of cool new stuff. It's not yet ready, but my friend Juan Gea from Bone Studio created this Bone Master branch that is the from this date. Check it out, because it has a lot of interesting stuff that we will have later on 3.1. We can access any attribute stored on Alembic, that is super interesting, because in a storm we are saving a lot of data on Alembic, and as well you can render directly in cycles without needing to instance anything. So let's see how it works. A storm, if you never use it, it's very easy. You can simulate all types of snow, grains, dirt, smoke, BDBs, you can do a lot of things. It's very easy to use, you will have the links below to download. And yeah, first you will add an object. I will add a granular system, you can add an SPH as well, but granular system is fine. Let's add a source, you have it here, with W you can move it, press a space, you are simulating, and it's freaking fast. And you can move it and it's interactive, all the cool stuff. But I don't want this, I want to switch it for an object. Now I import this object from a sketchfab that is a cube, it's unwrap, and I will show you as well how to apply textures in Blender from a storm. So I will change geo and I will select this OBJ, that is what I downloaded. You can import OBJs, Alembics, you can also import all different data like BDBs and other stuff, but that's what we need. If we press a space, we are simulating grains non-stop. We are simulating non-stop because here on single shot frame we have -1. This means that it's out of range, or range goes from 0 to 300, I think. If you put a specific frame like 1, now at frame 1 it will be created, but only once. And if you want to manipulate stuff like resolution, to have more resolution, it will be there. And you have all types of parameters here like friction, attraction, all the properties, you can control it from there. But so far, for what I want, I think 10 was fine. Another interesting thing is that we can do track UVs. If I click shift and click here, or you can do right click, you have a menu through. Now these, all the particles will check around and will grab the closest UVs from your object. Make sure that your object has UVs. My object already has UVs. So now if I reset and hit play, it will simulate with the UVs that you cannot see, but you will see it later. Now, when you want to save that, file preference, make sure to check this. By default, it's not checked. And I will save this on cache Minecraft. Select folder, and when I press, I can close that, reset, space, and this will be simulating on this folder. As said, it's very fast. I will show you other stuff later, but let's go to Blender. To import something, file, import, I want an Alembic because I saved it as an Alembic. Let's go to desktop and I do it UVs tutorial, cache Minecraft, should be this one. Now if you play, I forget something, let's do it again, file, import, Alembic. When you select it, make sure that it's sequence. Now you can move around, fine. And if you switch to render with cycles, there, if cycles, now when we render this, because this new branch automatically will render fine, as you can see. But we don't have colors, so how to access the colors that we are storing in a storm? And first, how to know all the data that we are creating with a storm? And now when we go to geometry nodes, we have here the spreadsheet that is automatically there. And on point data, we have all the information. So we can see that we have position, obviously, because these points are in a position. We have radius, emitter ID, number constraints, color, and emission ID, and we have the UVs here that I will show you later how to access them. But first, let's try to access this color, because this color gets saved into the Alembic. And to access it, let's go to shading and switch there to see cycles. And amazing. Now I will create a new material, and with Shift A I can access whatever. And I don't know much Blender, but it's very intuitive. I will go into input, I need an attribute, so here it is, and I need to name it as it is saved in a storm. And remember, you can go to the spreadsheet and you can see that the CD its color. So now go to shading, color into the base color, and boom, we have it. And yeah, now if we go there, you scroll, you can see that this data is there. But if you want to access the UV's color, how to do that? Let's go back to shading. Let's import a texture. Shift A, and we have texture, and we have image texture. You want to access a already created texture. And desktop, UV's tutorial, cache Minecraft. No, I save it on Minecraft Cube. You have this texture that is a PNG. I will create color with color, but how to access the UVs? And the UVs are stored per particle. And let's go back to the geometry nodes, the spreadsheet. Here, UV. So it's UV, easy. Let's go back to shading. So instead of CD, it will be UV. Oops, sorry. Make sure to write it well. And I don't know if capitals are important here, but yeah, it's no capitals, so let's keep it this way. And let's see what we have here. If I go color to base color, I have a color, but I have bluish and pinks. I don't like that. But let's see what happens if I connect it to the vector and color to color. And obviously it's wrong. And doesn't matter, I think, if you do vector or color. In this case, it's the same. Now, why this is wrong, and I had some problems before. If you go into vector, I think it is. Sometimes there is a tooltip here. I was able to get a tooltip before, and it was saying that you need U and B information. And yeah, it's, well, it was saying that, U and B. I think I was hovering it, or I don't know how I did it, but it expects U, V. And if we go to geometry nodes, spreadsheet, you can see that here, this is the X, Y, Z, but it's also U, V, W. And yeah, I think that, as you can see, there is only two components of UVs in Blender. If you use this data in Max or Arnold, rendering with V-Ray or Arnold or in Houdini, it will work as it is. But it's not UVW, so it's ignoring this third component Blender, actually. But we don't have any data on the V, but we have all the data on the W. So we need to do a little of math here. Simply we need to swap the data that is on the W on the V. So we can do this on shading. And if we go Shift A, we go to converter. I need separate X, Y, Z. This grabs a vector, that will be this vector, and separate it in the three components that are a scalar. And then I need to create this. So instead of separate, I need to combine X, Y, Z. So the X will be the X, as we saw, but now the Z will be the Y. So remember, this can be X, Y, Z, or can be U, B, W. So we are putting the W on the V. And if we do that, yay, this works. So here you have it, amazing. Pretty cool, right? We didn't use geometry nodes so far. But now I will explain how to use geometry nodes to do some other cool things. For the next example, I will maybe duplicate this. Ctrl C, Ctrl V, you duplicate it, and now I will have two objects, I think. Yes. Let's make something more interesting. I will try to make this collide one with the other. And direction X, make this at minus one, and this at zero. Reset. Okay, so now it's on the good direction. Let's make this faster, like two. And this will be, instead of minus one, this will be one, and as well two. Yeah, that's cool, but I think that needs more speed. Maybe we don't want gravity. So if we don't want gravity in global settings, it's in global particle system, you will have a default gravity. Let's put this at zero. And you can deactivate the ground if you want, but let's keep it as it is. So yeah, now we don't have gravity, but it's not breaking. So you can do two things. You can make this more velocity. Let's try this as well. Three and three. And we can make that the constraints are not so strong. On granular particle system, all the constraint data is here, constraint stiffness, and as well, constraint break stretch. So after this distance, it's between particles, it will break the constraints. So let's maybe decrease it. It will take less time to constrain. And we have this that, yeah, why not? Can be interesting. Another thing that you can do is that you can pre-break it at the start. And to do that, on show extra parameters, let's make this true. And you have more parameters here. And I will create a noise pre-breakup at true. And you can play with the scale that normally, yeah, you need to try it. You can see that at the first frames, you have some noise. And here the constraints are way not so strong. So now if we let it play, yeah, we have this breaking that, yeah, can be cool. So now we go back to Blender. And yeah, see how we don't need to do anything. And UVs are lost. That's kind of unfortunate. Let's check what's happening there. When you overwrite an Alembic, for so whatever reason on this version, it breaks the... It stops reading Alembic data. I think that's a bug for this version, but if I recreate it, it works again. We have this, that's pretty cool. But what if I only want one of these two objects? Maybe I am only interested in having one cube, not two. And yeah, you will need to resimulate this without this object. Can be problematic. But if we go into geometry nodes and we select this node in point, we have emitter ID and we have emitter ID 2 and we should have another emitter ID. There is emitter ID 2 and emitter ID 6. The numbers are a little random, but we have two different emitter IDs. And that's based, I think, on storm the number of things that you have here. But basically, it creates a random number every time that you create a different emitter. So we can now delete based on this emitter with geometry nodes. So when you are on geometry nodes, press new, and we have an input and an output. Basically, the geometry flows from the left to the right. And we can do things here. We can delete, for example, geometry, Shift A, and let's try, sorry, and it will not be Shift A. You can do Shift A and then press search, or you can do F3 and then check for delete. Okay, I don't know what's going on, but I am pretty sure that there is a delete geometry now. So now if I connect the geometry there, you can connect it or you can simply drag and drop. It's deleting everything. That makes sense because we are saying delete everything, but we have a selection. And we can select based in something. So for example, let's save based on an attribute. There are only some attributes that geometry node recognizes directly. And if you go into input, you will see that we have ID, index, normal, position, and radius. If I check, for example, position, that's reading the position parameters. And we can say delete everything that is higher than something. So we can, for example, here I will say vector, I need to do separate x, y, z. So now we can access the x, y, and z. So I can read the z position and say delete everything that is higher than 2, for example. For that, I don't even know, but I guess that it will be called compare. Yeah, compare floats looks like legit. Looks like it's what I am looking for. So let's say that I want that everything that is less than maybe 2, go into this selection. So now everything that is below 2 is getting deleted. But this is constantly. So anything at any point goes below 2, it will be deleted over time. If instead of doing that in X, we do this in Y, we can delete, for example, one part of the cube. But I don't want to access this position. I want to access this emitter ID. But to access this attributes, now we can with this version, but it's a little complicated, or, well, you need to know. Here you can drag and drop that, and on groups, we have inputs and outputs. I want to create a new input. So click the plus, create a new input. This emitter ID is an integer, so instead of float, I will create an integer, and I will give it a name. Can be the, whatever we have here or different. I will say, yeah, emitter is fine. Now you need to do a second step, and that's what it gets complicated, and in 3.1, I think that they want to change that, and is that when you create this, here we have on this panel, on geometry nodes, we have inputs that are here and outputs. We need to create, to associate this value that we create here, we need to associate it with this attribute that comes from the Alembic. I hope that it's clear. To do that, we need to click on this button here. This disappears. Now we click here and we can see all the data that comes from the Alembic. So we want an emitter ID. We are associating the emitter ID with this emitter. And now we have here an emitter. So we can say, okay, everything that is, instead of less, let's do equal. And we saw that we have two. Yeah, it works. So with two, we are eliminating one Alembic. And if we do six, that is the other one, we will delete the other one. So we can switch between one or the other. And I think that that's pretty cool, because now you can duplicate this if you want, you can move it, you can do whatever you want. And with this, we are losing the UVs. That's unfortunate. Actually, the problem that I found, it's a bug, but every time that you delete or the shading found that there is a different ID, when you delete or when you create a new update the cache, it will break. So we can do different things, and that's a cool thing about geometry nodes, is that it's flexible. Instead of deleting it, we will change the radius to zero. To change the radius, Shift A, and I think there is set point radius. This looks, that is what we want. If I go directly there, let's see what this does. By default it's 0.05, but if we increase this to 0.2, this is way bigger. And yeah, going to zero, it will disappear, but the default is 0.05. So what I will do is that I will reduce this at zero, but only when this is true. So now we are doing exactly the same as we was doing before. So 2 and 6. So we have the two values and we can delete one or the other. It's kind of like a hack, but it works. Now, something I want to show that it's very important is this emission pause. That's because when you want to delete something, to do it over time, if you do it over the position, it will not work. I will need to showcase an example. Let's say, okay, something that I need here, it's a timeline. Let's say that I want to delete all the top part, all the green, all. Let's say that I want to delete everything that is not green, all the bottom part. If I do it, I can expose the position, Shift A, input position, that's fine. As we saw, we can convert this with vector separate XYZ, and we can say, okay, I want to delete everything that is below this green stuff. So instead of the emitter, I want to select the Z, and this will be, let's see, not equal, but less than. Okay, that makes sense. Okay, so I will delete everything that is not green. But what's the problem? That over time, the particles, when, because this is only evaluating at each frame, the data that it has, and it's evaluating over the position, if one particle goes below this position, it will get deleted over time. But maybe I don't want that, because you can see that this will flicker and do weird things, as you can see here. I want that only delete the particles on the first frame, and then if they are deleted on the first frame, they keep deleted later. Normally you cannot do that with Blender, because Blender has no concept of time. In Houdini you will have a time shift and you will be able to use time shift, but you don't have this here. But in a Storm, for each particle we are saving the original position, so even if the particles move, the emission position is static. You can see that the position, obviously, over time, when they change, the values change, but not the emit position, because it's the initial frame position. This is not moving. And we need to access this. So as we did before, let's create another input. Now, instead of an integer, will be a vector. I will call this initPost. You can call this whatever you want. The important thing is, like, after here, we connect this with the correct one. It's the emission post. So we are making a link between the attribute that comes from Alembic with the attribute that we name here, and it's coming in initPost. So now, if instead of using this position that it's evaluated per frame, we use the initial position, now we have this, and it's that, let me deselect that, okay. So on the first frame, we are not, we're deleting everything, but now you will not see any particle getting deleted, even if this particle goes below. Before, this particle was getting deleted, now not anymore. And that's super powerful. Let's do the same based by proximity. So if I want to do based by proximity, we have shift A, we have, I always forget that, search proximity or target. Let's create a monkey, a Suzanne. My beautiful Suzanne. So yeah, let's put it there. Rotate set there. Let's see the face of this Suzanne. So yeah, let's call this. To call a geometry, we need to do an object info. Object info. And you have this pipette, you can select the monkey. And this will be your target, the geometry target. Source position, again, you can use the position that will be evaluated per frame, but then it will not be kept constant wherever you delete. We can use the init position instead. And now we have position and distance. We want to evaluate the distance. This is becoming a little messy. So this distance there, we don't need that, we don't need that. Yeah, let's clean up this thing. I know that with Control H, that's a tip from Juan. You can hide whatever you don't need. But yeah, now we are deleting, but we are doing something very weird and I don't know what it is. You can move this. And I can see that this is based on the monkey, but if it was the origin, it was in the origin. That's because it's using the original. You need to use the relative to use the world position. And now it's doing what I will expect. As you can see, if I move around, I will be deleting wherever I am selecting. And yeah, when I delete these particles on frame zero, now they are will keep deleted. Doesn't matter that they move away from Suzanne, they will be deleted. If you want to be deleted per frame, you will switch, you will not use the as a source position this init post, but you will use the global position. But that's super powerful because now you can delete, if you want to delete something specifically, you want to delete only this that is close to Suzanne, yeah, you can do it. You don't need to resim that. You delete whatever you want and then it gets a stick there. So super powerful. You can do all types of things with this. You can control, for example, the radius. Let's say that I want to control the radius based on distance. How I will do that, I will do, you have a curve that I like a lot. And I think it's in utilities, I guess. Compare float, float curve, this float curve. It's getting an input and giving a different output. So this set point radius, let's say that I want to change this and I want this be based on distance, but I don't want the selection. I want to replace directly the radius. So remember, we have this radius there. I will grab the distance and let's convert, let's convert this distance to something else. It's very important to check the values. The X is the incoming and the Y is the output. So the incoming will be zero, that's fine. The output, the incoming output, I think that this distance more or less will be 5 or 6. So the incoming output will be 6. You can do a clam or a fit range, whatever. That's Houdini terms, but there is the equivalent here for sure. And max Y is the maximum radius that I want, that will be in this case 0.1. So with this done, I think it's extend horizontal or reset view. I'm not totally sure how this works. I think it's like that. I always get confused a little with this. Yeah, I get this. I don't know if it's a bug or it's me that I am. I don't know how to make it work. If in the comments knows how to fix that, let me know, because I always go crazy trying to do the... There is extend horizontal, but there is not extend vertical. What the fuck? And I don't know why it's like going so crazy. So when this happens, sometimes... Float curve again. I know that it's something that I am doing wrong, but max y, I need this to be 6 for sure. I will keep the max y at 1. I think that this is the safest. Reset view. But the reset view is always doing that. Okay. And now let's do extend horizontal. Yeah, something like that. Okay, between x and 1. I don't like at all how this works, but whatever. Who I am to criticize Blender. And now I will do a fit wrench. Let's see if I found it. I guess it is in utilities, clam. It's a map wrench. That's what I was looking for. And I want to the clam, the max will be 1 and the maximum one will be 0.1. That will make it 2. So yeah, now it works. I guess that if I do this at 1, everything will be 0.1, and now I can do things like that. But obviously we don't have anything disconnected to anything, so stupid from my part. Let's connect this to value, and yeah. Max X is 6. Oh, I am connecting this to that, but I don't want that. Distance to value. Now this makes sense. And here is how you will do what I was trying to do. I hope that you like it. My master thing that I'm not sure what it is, but... And the cool thing is, like, now this is fixed. So the radius are static on place. Maybe this will be cool to display how if you use the position instead of the initial position, you will have problems there, because using point, input, position, and I use this as a source position, this will be drafting, and you don't want that, you see? Maybe it's difficult to see, but these particles there are moving, going there, and when I use the init pause, this is not happening. The particles stay in place. Whatever how far they travel, they will have always the same radius. Cool, something new that we learned with that. Let's say how to work with outputs. The output is the same. Let's say that I want to not use this texture, but I want to use a different color based on proximity, for example. And yeah, we have this. I will, the radius, let's keep the radius at 0.07. I will, there is a RAM, I think. So when I don't know things, I go to color, color RAM. It's everything there. Actually, I am pretty jealous of all this, because yeah, it was released on the 2.8, 2.9, but it improved a lot geometry nodes. You have all types of nodes now. So let's create some trippy color thing. This will be red. I think it's control, yes. I will create a blue there. Nice. I don't know. In green, yes. And what can be this? This can be this. Whatever. So I want to use this as a color. So I need to create an output. Here we have been creating inputs. Let's create outputs. And this will be a color. And the name will be, I don't know, my color. Whatever, but now you need to associate it outside. Again, this the association that happens here, I think in 3.1 it will change. You will not need to do this double association that I found stupid. You don't need to associate anything with Alembic, but you need to associate it to one attribute that you will use outside geometry nodes. And this can be my color. And now this is the name of the attribute that you will use somewhere else. In this case, I will go to the shading Let's remember to connect this to this. And now let's go to shading template. And yeah, instead of using this there, let's disconnect this, connect this directly to color. And remember, we call it my color. So yeah, amazing. Now you can move this disco ball. Yay. And yeah, moving the particles get a stick to his original position. This is super powerful because we can do so many things with geometry nodes to do post operations over your already seen cache. You don't need to be seen when you need to fix some extra a particle that you don't like it. You can kill it directly with geometry nodes. You can scale it. You can say, okay, particles that goes close to camera and are too big. You can make that when something goes close to camera, the scale is smaller. You can change color. We didn't tweak here things, but you have as well number of constraints. We have, for example, velocity. With velocity, we can tweak the radius be bigger when faster it's these particles. You can do so many things. That was only some examples. I am not good at all on geometry nodes, but as you can see, if you come, I come from Magma Flow and Houdini in Bobs. It's exactly the same as in Bobs in Houdini. It's the same as in Magma Flow. You only need to know the names, and for what I see, you have almost everything there. Simply check. It's very well named, I think, for an artist. It's easy to find things. They have already most of the stuff. Something that I want to point out, we have been rendering these as spheres. If you want to replace this by another object, you will do it with an instance. And I think it's called instance to points, yeah. Ah, sorry, you don't need instance to points, you need instance on points, makes sense. I was missing some stuff there. This is not Houdini. But how you will do it is that, yeah, points will be connected to geometry, and the instance, you will use an object info to connect to this instance. And then you will instance whatever it is, the rock or Suzanne. The problem doing that on this specific version is that the attributes that are used on shading will not work. So you will lose, if you want to shade something based on a color that you set here on this output, will not work. You will need to convert to mesh, and I don't suggest to do that because then you lose the instances, and when you work with a storm and you work with thousands of objects and you don't have instance, your RAM will explode. That's a limitation that they know, and in theory will be fixed in 3.1, so then you will use this together with all this. But I hope that all this tutorial you was able to follow. I rambled a little bit, but to showcase how powerful it is, Blender together with a storm, and I hope that you can use it in a lot of your projects. Let me know. We have the Discord where ask me anything. There is people with Blender that maybe can help you better than me, but I will try to help with whatever I can. Thank you so much, guys. See you soon. Bye.